I'm Dr. Nitin Sobel, and I'm going to talk on peripheral arterial disease. So typically, there are two broad indications for peripheral arterial disease. One is you get patients who are suspected to have arterial disease, and you need to answer questions like, is it an arterial problem? If it is, then where is it? How much is it? What is the nature of disease? What is the status of collaterals? How is the distal runoff? So when you do the test, at the back of your mind, we need to keep, we need to plan therapeutic options so that your test is more relevant as far as the clinical situation is concerned. There's another group of patients who typically, where an intervention has been done and you are asked to evaluate. This is becoming more common, like post-operative, post-stenting or post-bypass grafts. We'll see some example. And then there is another group, like, for example, evaluating pseudoaneurysms, aneurysms, etc. We won't go into that today. Now, inner peripheral arteries always take a history, diabetes, smoking, very, very important, claudication. Then palpate all the pulses, and most important, take at least an ankle to brachial index. This is very simple. You don't need such sophisticated tests. You need to do a pressure at a level of the ankle and at a level of the upper arm. So typically, the ankle brachial index is more than one. Lower the ankle brachial index, more is the severity of the ischemia. And this gives us a clue that, okay, something is definitely wrong and we need to look at it properly. We can also take segmental pressures in the upper thigh, upper calf, lower calf. And this also, if there's a fall in the segmental pressure, this again gives us a clue as to where the disease is. Typically, as we know, that if there's a fall at one point, the disease is likely to be proximal to that. So with these clues, we go ahead. Now, why is this important? This is important because a treatment of peripheral arterial disease is basically symptom-based and not anatomy-based. That means at times, anatomically, you can have a large lesions. Patient may not be symptomatic, and then we don't treat them aggressively. Whereas sometimes the anatomical lesion is small, but the symptoms are more, and we need to treat them aggressively, especially when the patient is young. So remember the anatomy again. We have, of course, we start with the aorta, then iliacs, and the femoral artery. Now, some areas are difficult. For example, the iliac bifurcation can be difficult. The adductor canal can be difficult. The trifurcation of the popliteal artery can be difficult. But we'll see how to overcome these difficult areas. Always begin with the aorta in a longitudinal plane and in a transverse plane. Now, transverse plane is again very important because sometimes the aorta becomes ectatic, or you might have a focal aneurysm, and you might see a miss on a part of the aorta, in fact, if you do it only longitudinally. So this again gives us a good idea about the walls of the aorta. The longitudinal again is very, very important because you can pick up atherosclerosis, you can look at pulsatility of the aorta, which can be a clue to several diseases, and we can trace, go right up to the bifurcation of aorta. The bifurcation of aorta is very important because that's a common site of atherosclerosis. It's a common site of aneurysms. That's where aneurysms start. So that is very, very important. For the iliacs, I like to tilt the patient, typically right side up for the right side, left side up for the left. This because usually have a lot of gases in this area. And once you tilt the patient, then you can overcome this and you can actually look at the vessels in a much, much better way. And it's easy to interrogate this way also. For the femorals, we like to externally rotate the leg and go medially, and it's very important to expose the entire leg, right, expose the inguinal area, because looking at common femoral artery, the bifurcation of common femoral artery is again very, very important. So expose the patient properly, do a good grayscale, because very often you have plaques which will be missed if you directly switch on color Doppler. There's oversaturation of color. So I always prefer to do a grayscale, whether it's a peripheral artery, carotid, or of course, whether it's veins. Typically, when we switch on color, when you are in the proximal portion of the SCFA or the proximal SFA, we like to tilt the probe on this side, tilt the beam on this side. Once we go distally, we like to tilt the beam on the other side. That's the normal color. We see red, blue, red, blue. This blue in the center of the red is because of aliasing, because of high velocities, as we know. And the blue coming up intermittently is because of the reversal of flow. So peripheral arteries have a triphasic flow. forward one reversal of diastole and then a forward diastolic flow. That's a classical of a peripheral artery disease. It's very often referred to as a multiphasic waveform. When we go to the adductor canal, sometimes it is difficult to see the adductor canal with a linear probe, and therefore we might use a convex probe which has a lower frequency popliteal. Or we can ask the patient to lie down prone. Sometimes the patient has a bandage or is not able to lie down prone, we can just tilt them on one side and look at the popliteal artery from the sides. The bifurcation of the popliteal artery is very, very important to evaluate. So for the posterior tibial artery, we can trace it right from origin. We go medially, of course, and usually the posterior tibial artery will be accompanied by two veins on either side. It becomes very easy. And then once you spot it, you can go down right up to the medial malleolus or at ankle joint. Sometimes it is easy to locate it here and then go up. So whatever way you want, you can do. This is important, the tibio-peroneal trunk. That's the anterior tibial artery, which comes straight onto the probe. You don't have to do angle correction for that. And the peroneal artery, which is deeper. These are both very, very important arteries. So here we are tracing the peroneal artery, which, as I said, is relatively deeper, and you can go right down. Fortunately, all three arteries have accompanying veins, and that makes them easy to identify. We can look at dorsal aspides again, which is again a continuation of anterior tibial artery. Again, typically a high resistance waveform. And then we can look at plantars also. Nowadays, it's easy to look at plantars. But it is difficult to look at toes as compared to the fingers in the upper limb. But we can go right up to the base of the toes. Now, why is it important to look at aorta? Because very often the clue is in the aorta. You can have atherosclerosis, you can have thrombosis, you can have aneurysms, you can have dissections, anything. So if you miss this, then your examination goes haywire. There's an example of a patient who has got an iliac artery occlusion. There are a lot of collaterals. And again, his distal external iliac or the common femoral is filling through collaterals. So if someone is very new and sees this waveform and may feel, oh, this looks like normal and can miss on an iliac occlusion. This has happened in practice. So the normal waveform in a peripheral artery is a triphasic waveform. We have a quick systolic upstroke, one downward flow, one forward, and then absent diastolic flow. And this is because, of course, their limbs do not require blood flow throughout cardiac cycle. So that's when the blood is normal, of course, that's the basics. Then we have a laminar flow with a clear window. Moment there's a plaque, there is turbulence. We have the entire window filling up with multiple dots. That tells us that there is something wrong here. But the velocities will not increase if the stenosis is not significant. Moment the stenosis becomes significant, associated with all filling of the window, we have increase in velocity, which is directly proportional to the degree of stenosis. So typically, if the velocity increase 100%, then we know that we are dealing with more than 50% stenosis. If the velocity is increased by 4 times the proximal segment, then we know it is 75%. So what is very important in all Dopplers is comparison with proximal segment. Because typically upstream 2 centimeters above the site of evaluation, if the velocity is say 100 and then it becomes 200, we know it is 50% stenosis. So there are no shortcuts. We have to take multiple readings at multiple points, and we'll see how we do it in practice. So here's a classical day-to-day example. This patient has a gangrene, and as we go down from into the femoral artery, as we go to the mid portion of femoral artery, we can see this aliasing and narrowing there on color Doppler. And on pulse Doppler proximally, we can see this monophasic waveform instead of a triphasic. This again tells us that something is going to go wrong if nothing has gone wrong proximally. And rightly so, at the site of stenosis, we can see that the velocities have increased to 400 centimeters per second from 70s or 80s, telling us it's more than 50%, almost like 75%, almost like 400, so 75% stenosis. So there again on color Doppler, you can see aliasing, you can see perivascular tissue vibration, telling us that this is a very, very significant stenosis. So further down in the same patient, we look at a popliteal, we look at the posterior tibial. We can see that there are severe atherosclerotic changes. There is hardly any flow on color Doppler happening. And we traced right, and you can see that the flow is monophasic. It is classically tardous power systole. telling us that this blood has come through a severely atherosclerotic stenosis, and that's what we saw approximately. And we traced it right up to the end. The anterior artery shows partly, part of the anterior artery is occluded. There are some collaterals happening there, and we can trace it right up to the foot. And when we look at the dorsalis pedis again, we can see some flow, but the flow is dampened monophasic otitis powers, and that's a patient who had gangrene. We could see this flow right up to the base of the toes. So that's a very important information which you can give to the clinician. Usually they want to know how the flow is, whether the plantar arches are patent and whether there's flow right up to the base of the toe. That's another example again, stenosis of the SFA with aliasing with very high velocities, almost 75% stenosis. So normally we have a triphasic waveform. If it is mono, if it is becomes biphasic instead of multiphasic, that means there is a arterial vasoconstriction or an obstruction distal to the sampling site. If it becomes monophasic, then we again know that there's a arterial occlusion distal to the sampling site, or sometimes this can happen in a combined proximal and severe arterial disease. And if it is monophasic tardis powers with increased time taken to reach the peak systole, we know that there has been a proximal stenosis or occlusion. So that's a classical example of a tardis powers waveform seen in the distal tibial artery in a patient who had a popliteal artery occlusion. Sometimes in ischemia, the triphasicity of course is lost because now the tissues want more blood to come. Therefore, there is distal vasodilatation, and you can see a high diastolic flow in the peripheral arteries. Sometimes the waveform in the peripheral arteries become almost like a vein. That is because the arteries lose their tone. They no longer offer any resistance. They become like a vein, and you can see a continuous flow like this, telling us that there is a distal vasodilatation and ischemia. Then, of course, you can have thrombus. This video is not running. But typically, when you have a thrombus, you see perivascular tissue vibration, or the tissues around the thrombus vibrate, because the blood comes with a lot of kinetic energy, hits against the dead wall, and that energy basically spreads to the surrounding tissue. And that's a classical waveform which you get prior and distal to the occlusion. Look out for collaterals. That's a profunda artery which is dilated because the SFA is blocked. And that's an SFA which is totally occluded, but there's a very good collaterals. And I was saying that if you have such good collaterals and the patient is old and does not have much of symptoms, and if the physiological tests are fairly good, then one may not be very aggressive about such long segment occlusions also. Look at the extent of disease here. You can see a line of demarcation of ischemia, and rightly so. On color Doppler, we can see that the profunda is quite okay, but the SFA is totally blocked, and that explains why this part of the thigh shows a good color. Cause of the disease, common of course, is atherosclerosis, diabetic atherosclerosis, typically with lot of calcification in the wall. Burgers, not very common in the lower limb, but occasionally of course we see. Typically the arteries are markedly thick walled, and they look like almost like an umbilical arteries. Of late, we have been seeing COVID-19 presenting as lower limb ischemia or thrombosis because of the multiple factors which are active in a COVID situation. Here's an example of a young person who came with from Rajesh's clinic, who came with ischemia in the leg, and he had symptoms which were there only for a few hours. He had a total occlusion of the SFA and was subsequently a COVID positive case. So normally, there are a lot of interventions which are done, angioplasties are done, stent support. We can have thrombolytic therapy, which is again becoming popular. We can have grafts. So let's see just some examples. That's a patient who's got an aortofemoral graft, and you can see that on the right side, it is blocked. Now it's very important whenever a patient has come to you after intervention to look at a history to find out what sort of a graft or stent has been put, because otherwise examination can be difficult. Venous grafts are very difficult to evaluate because they're very thin, and very often if they're normal, they collapse when you put a pressure on your probe. Venous grafts have valves. There are two types, as we know. One is in situ and one is reversed vein graft, but it's very important to monitor venous grafts. Then that's a stent, and you can see that there is a stent stenosis. That's a perivascular tissue vibration with mosaic color telling us that there is a segment of stenosis. We can have patients after trauma coming with edema, and this is a classical compartment syndrome. What we see here is a pan reversal of flow in the femoral artery and in the proximal portion of the posterior tibial artery. Now, this is very diagnostic of a compartment syndrome, telling us that there's a very high resistance. That's another example again of a compartment syndrome. On the left side, on the right side, we can see a normal triphasic waveform in the femoral artery. On the left side, we can see a pan reversal of flow, telling us that there is soft tissue edema. You can see some fluid there, and you need to do fasciotomy and release the pressure. Sometimes after orthopedic surgery, the patients lose their pulse. The clinician wants to know, is it compartment syndrome or is it a block? Here, for example, we have a tibio-peroneal block and the patient had to be opened up again. Sometimes after trauma, patients may have a vasospasm, typically which may last for quite some time. This is a young girl who had a trauma of the actually of her fingers, and there was a vasospasm which lasted for quite some time. But after some time, when we look at the radial artery, it opened up and we see a good diastolic flow. So at the end of it, give a chart and answer the fundamental questions that are, is it an arterial problem? Where is it? How much is it? What is the length of the lesion? What is the status of collateral? What is the sort of disease? And what is the status of distal vessels? All these points are very, very important for the clinician to make a decision. Thank you so much for your attention.